All right, so no further ado, Theresa E. is going to talk about deconstructing labels. I'll let her tell what that's about.
Hi, everyone.
Yay!
My name's Theresa, and I'm just going to, full disclosure, I do not have a plan for today.
Woo!
I know, and I taught that class yesterday on facilitating and told you all over there that you need to have an agenda. But I do have an agenda, I just don't know how to facilitate that agenda. Because I've never been someone that assigned labels to myself. I was not in the cool kids club at school, I wasn't even cool enough to be in the nerds kids club at school. I was like the person that kind of went around wherever I went around and did what I did. When I registered to vote, I registered as an independent. I've never been someone that assigned labels to myself until Occupy. And then I assigned myself the label of Occupier. And I've never had to defend myself so much in my life against people's ignorance about what it meant to be an occupier. The same thing happened when I attached another label to my name, Free Stater. When I attached the name to myself, that when I said that I was a Free Stater, people would often tell me, they would assign what they thought it was that a Free Stater was without actually knowing anything about me. And so I always found I found that kind of frustrating, because I think that labels have a purpose. Like when you're eating your food, it's really important to know what's in your food, so labels are really kind of good there. And when you're talking to people, it can be good to know what labels people associate with themselves, because maybe it gives you an idea about who those people are. But it doesn't necessarily tell you much more than what you assign to that little tiny label. However, I see a lot, and by a lot I mean more than a lot, to the extent that honestly I almost titled this Fuck Factions. Because, but it wasn't family friendly enough. Because I really, yeah. Like, I see a lot of people who assign these labels to themselves or assign labels to other people, and suddenly because they have this label associated next to their name, maybe not even formally, they can't work with that person. And so for me, I find that extremely frustrating, because what I work on, what I want people to know how to do is to grow their own food. And I don't know about you guys, but I haven't met a socialist yet who doesn't need to eat. I haven't met a communist yet who doesn't need to eat. I haven't met a capitalist yet who doesn't need to eat. We have all of these common things going on in our lives, so much more in common than we actually have that separates us. And we end up fighting about those things because of labels. So what I want to do today is try and talk about, how do we deconstruct the labels? How do we get beyond those things like calling people a statist? Because I'll tell you what, when I read things about Massachusetts, is anybody here from Massachusetts? Okay, I apologize in advance for this. But whenever I read something about Massachusetts, or whenever I go into Salem, because I used to live in Massachusetts for a really long time, and I love Salem, it's one of my favorite cities. But you drive down and you see cops driving down roads at 20 miles an hour, not even, like 15 probably, with license plate scanners on both sides. And my response is, freaking statists. Like, it's kind of ridiculous. And I have to stop myself from that kind of thinking, because it really does detract from me being able to even meet my own potential. If I can't even think of in my own terms, if I think in labels, then how am I supposed to have a conversation with any of you about how we move beyond them? So I'm not coming here as some kind of an expert to tell you how to do this. I'm trying to facilitate a conversation where we can figure out how we do this. So the first thing I'd like to do, and I actually, can I get a volunteer to help me out up here? Come on up. Thank you. If I need another one, you'll be my next one. So if you could write up here what people say, in case you didn't know, there's some audience participation here. I would like everybody to just shout out labels that you've been called, or labels that you've called other people.
Fascist.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good one. I've been called...
called fascist and hippie on the same day.
Yeah. Seriously. It's like you can't... Yep.
Wow.
Yeah, no, seriously. It's nutty.
Thanks,
what people
Facebook.
Will do. I'm going to just be like, I'm going to put hippie. Because that's when I get. I also get socialist.
Mm-hmm.
I've also gotten, what else? Let's see.
Racist.
Oh, yeah. Totally racist. I've been called racist a lot. I'm actually okay with it, because I actually think that it's not the worst thing in the world for somebody to call you racist, because at least then you can talk to them and find out what they think a racist is and why they would call you that and kind of move on from that. But I've been called racist lots of times. go ahead and have that. Yep, add it on. Right, because what's white? I mean, I'm a mutt. I don't know about you guys. I don't even know all of the different, like, bloodlines from nations somewhere along the way that maybe don't even exist anymore run through my veins. So yeah, races.
For genders?
I didn't want to go there quite yet, but that's, yeah, genders.
What else?
Leftist, right wing.
Oh, leftist, oh yeah.
Right-winger.
That's my kid. okay.
Mom.
Oh yeah, I like that label.
Yeah.
Right-wing nut job.
Yep. Wing nut. Anarchist. Mm-hmm. Who's been called an anarchist? Who calls themselves an anarchist?
Extremist.
That's a good one, yeah.
Terrorist.
Idealist.
Pollyanna, typically. I get called Pollyanna a lot. I think that's why idealist, like, in a way that isn't so name-calling-y. What's that?
Platonist. I
call
people
Platonists
constantly. What
is that?
I don't
want to
get into it right now.
Does anybody here know what a Platonist is?
Never heard.
Yeah. I'm Googling that.
He's right. Plato.
You're going to explain it to me, Carlton, please.
I'm going to explain it to you.
Well, he doesn't want to. You don't have to explain it now.
I'm just guessing from the word origin.
Plato believes in the concept of forms that you're supposed to live life for the sake of our
reward.
That's
right.
Oh.
Being a Platonist is the worst thing.
How you write that?
P-L-A-T-O, I don't know.
See, I'm learning new labels. It's crazy. And so, when you have all of these names, these things kind of getting in the way, well, how many of you feel like these help you? Yeah. So sometimes, like, I don't necessarily mind when people call me a hippie. I never really felt like a hippie. People have been calling me a hippie since well before I ever actually would have assigned myself that title. I was always kind of like, what are you talking about? But it does kind of give you a sense of comfort. It gives me a sense of comfort to be a Free Stater. It gives me a sense of comfort because, to me, the Free State Project represents my community. It represents people who have similar values to me and people who I can work with on a lot of things. It also represents people who my daughter's friends' parents don't like. And it also represents people who, if you say the word Free State Project, you get jumped on. Now, I went to a progressive summit 2 years ago and I talked about Occupy and about the Free State Project. I think I'd already been banned from Occupy at that point. I can't remember. It was either right before I got banned or right after I got banned that I was there. And I was there talking about all of the things that we have in common, because really when it comes down to what we're trying to do, there, like, everybody argues about the solution. We haven't even correctly identified the problem in most instances. And we talk about the solution, like the big solution, when we haven't figured out the smallest problem. And I think if we stopped arguing, people who argue about whether or not you're an anarchist or a minarchist, I honestly would like you to just go outside and plant a garden, please. Because it is really... There is a big difference, but what does it matter right now? Today, what does it matter? When you're sitting there arguing with somebody about those things, argue about those things when you're setting up a group and you have to come to decisions about how decisions are going to be made and you have to figure those things out. That's the time to have those arguments. But, like, we have a lot of work to do. I am as guilty as anybody else in engaging in these kinds of things. I do tend to kind of think before I post and think, I would never say something anywhere that I wouldn't say to somebody's face. I wouldn't say anything to another person. I wouldn't say something online. I would not say something anywhere, just that I would not say to somebody's face. And so it keeps me really honest and it keeps me accountable. Because, quite frankly, even now, knowing that I just said that, sometimes I'll meet people and they'll say, oh, I've seen your stuff on Facebook. And my immediate response is, oh, I'm sorry. Because I'm a pain in the butt. I'm not the one that's going to sit there and, like, try and, like, take a side in an argument. I'm the one that's going to sit there and say, wait, hold on a second. Is this really happening right now? Are you really having this fight right now, and is this really important, especially since it's 2 years old? I'm not the one, I'm very much the one that's going to be honest about what's going on in a conversation, and it pisses everyone off. Nobody really, not nobody, people very often get annoyed by people like me, because I will be the one that kind of says, excuse me, this isn't really in line with our values, even when it's the most inconvenient thing to say. And even when that thing makes me feel like I'm really putting my own personal, like, affiliation with people at risk. But if you can't be accountable to your intentions, then what can you be accountable for? And if you have a stated group intention, then you need to be accountable to that. That being said, there are ways to talk to people that have nothing to do with labels. I find if I ask a lot of questions, I tend to move beyond those things really quickly. And I've gotten places, I don't really get too caught up when somebody assigns a label to me because they don't know me, like really, like how many people really know you? So somebody can assign a label to you. It's just what their perception of you is in their reality. It doesn't actually mean anything. So what that triggers me to do oftentimes is to start asking questions. Like, oh, okay, what is it about what I just said or what I just did that makes you feel that way? And keep digging until I have the response that I actually understand where they're coming from. And 9 times out of 10, by the time I've gotten to that point, they've already de-escalated from their name calling and kind of found that we're on common ground. And I've made a lot of friends that way. I have a lot of friends who are communists, I have a lot of friends who are socialists, and I'm not the most well-read individual in the world. I do not have time for that. And I kind of regret that when I was did have time, I used to read a book a day. Unfortunately, it was like trashy romance novels and stuff. It was like fiction. And I feel like I wasted an opportunity there, but I was like 16, so whatever. But I'm not the most well-read person. I can't tell you about what people were thinking when they formed their political ideology hundreds of years ago. I can tell you that I feel like what we're doing right now is fighting thousands of years of very, very intentional conditioning and programming for us to be able to all kind of get in a line and follow where we're supposed to go and do what we're supposed to do and what we're doing. The critical thinking that people do in order to get to where they feel like they're liberating themselves is counterculture. Ooh, I should put that label up there because counterculture, I've been called that and radical. And people say radical, like everybody thinks I'm about to be arrested all the time. My family has conversations about when I'm gonna get arrested. I've come close to being arrested, but I've never been arrested. Like, I'm not out there actively seeking policing. No, thank you. I would rather not have to record police because I would rather not be in any interaction where there is a police officer present. So that is not on my list of things to do. But people think that because I protest and because I speak publicly about the way I think, that I am going to be arrested. And quite frankly, they may be justified in thinking that. A lot of my friends have been targeted and are in prison. Most of them are journalists, which tells you something about where they're targeting and why they're targeting people in this country. So when I look at, and I'm sort of really tangential today because like I said, I don't really have a plan for this. But I feel like if we can start to have conversations with each other beyond the philosophical debate and more about the what can we do together now, we'll get so much more accomplished so much more quickly. Because there's all of these awesome things going on, even in New Hampshire. New Hampshire has its own, like the Free State Project does kind of have its own sort of factions. They're not like formal factions or anything. But you have these people over here doing this and these people over here doing that and these people over here. And it's all of these little silos. Silos of activism. Silos, and those are things like farming, media, cop block, the Quill, Area 23, which doesn't exist, it exists here, but physically does not exist right now until they find a new place. But it's an awesome place where you can go and learn whatever you want to learn or teach whatever you want to teach. Those things all exist, but they kind of exist separately. And one of the other things that I think people do with the labels and with activism is judge it, like yours isn't good activism. I had somebody say to me the other day that it is an acceptable form, if you're not going out and doing activism, homeschooling is an acceptable excuse for that. I was like, fuck, what? Did you, do you, how many, does anybody in here homeschool?
I have.
Okay. I have. How easy is homeschooling?
Oh, it's fun.
Yeah, but how easy is it? Especially when you're first starting. It is time consuming. Mm-hmm. It is hard. There is no,
it's
like,
work.
It is absolutely work. And my husband and I, we homeschool one of our children, and it takes, and we both work full-time jobs. So somebody homeschooling is absolute activism. There is nothing more important than what we're teaching the children that we are raising right now. They are going to be the ones to take what we've accomplished and move it forward. I believe the children are the future. Okay, I'm sorry.
Where did that hippie label come from?
But it's, I do honestly think that what we're doing is really important, but I believe, truly, if we see liberty in our lifetime, I personally think you see liberty when you choose it. I don't think you're granted liberty. I don't think there's liberty outside of yourself. I believe that we are living in a society that does not agree with me. And so I have to go get a license and I have to go do all these things, and that's fine. I can live in that society. But I also think that to really achieve what it is that we're trying to achieve, it's going to take generations. And if we're not passing on better than what we've done, if we aren't learning from our mistakes, if we aren't growing beyond where we started from, then we're wasting the opportunity that we have. And as far as I'm concerned, Occupy was not a failure. And if anyone wants to talk about that in detail, I'm happy to do so, because I can talk about, I was very lucky in Occupy. I don't know, you know, I was never somebody that was a leader at all, ever in my life, until Occupy. We're in a leaderless movement. Is where I discovered my leadership potential. But being a leader doesn't necessarily mean telling people what to do. It just means connecting dots and putting people together and saying 1 + 1 = 2. You want to accomplish this? Well, this person's working on that, and those would be symbiotic. Why don't you try those together? So I was really lucky that I learned that skill at Occupy, and because of that, I kind of ended up being picked for this thing where I was one of 5 people nationally who got to vote on how to spend money that was donated by Ben and Jerry's and some other people to fund activist stuff. And so I got to see things from all over the country. And I got to see things that people have been working on for decades and never had a chance to actually bring to the surface. And I got to talk with people who were much more seasoned activists than I am now. I'm still a noob. I'm still trying to figure it all out. But I got to meet all of these people. And all of them, probably, I would say half of them would be terrified of the Free State Project just because of some of the words we use, because words are scary. But I think if they ever actually came here and talked, and when I talk to them about what we need to do, we all agree on the same things. We all agree that we need to take power back and that we need to start building local communities and that we need to be trying to literally be the change. Me and my hippie stuff again. But honestly, there's no other way to change things than to be the change you want to see in the world. You cannot change anyone, you cannot change anything unless you first change yourself and unless your actions are going to actively change something. It's a lot of responsibility, to be honest with you. But this here in New Hampshire is the best thing I've seen in my life, definitely. I've never read about anything quite like this before. And it's kind of amazing. But we have to reach our own potential. And we have to be able to kind of reach out to those people who are afraid to talk to us. Who are like sitting there at the same summit that I spoke to 2 years ago, had a summit this year. And one of the topics for discussion was targeting the leaders of the Free State Project. It wasn't called Targeting the Leaders of the Free State Project. It was something else like find out who the leaders of the Free State Project are, something like that. But it's a targeting campaign because the way that they see it, what we're talking about is so scary. The idea that we could do something without the use of government force is so scary to them that they actually had a panel so that they could target people. I was there 2 years ago. They weren't scared of me then. And my friends were there this year talking about New Hampshire Rebellion, which is a group that's trying to get money out of politics in New Hampshire. I work with so many individuals who are at that conference that it upsets me. Because it's like, there's never been a time where I've done something that would ever make anyone really feel like I would be a threat, unless accountability and transparency are threatening to you, in which case, like I said, I'm kind of a pain in the ass. I really feel as though in order for the Free State Project to be successful, and sorry for those of you who've been to a couple of my talks this week, because, geez, I sound like a broken record. The Free State Project, yes, triggering the move is important, but you don't trigger the move and then bam, magical fairy wand waves and you live in a free society. The idea of the Free State Project is that you get those people to move here and then you start building community. And building community means talking to those people who are really afraid of you. And those people who you're really afraid of. And I don't know that anybody wants to start talking about who they're afraid of. I know who I'm afraid of. I'm afraid of cops. I'm terrified of cops. I'm terrified of them, but I'll still stand up to them. Because I shouldn't have to be terrified of them. And I know that. I also get scared of people who are doing things like who are the leaders of the Free State Project. Because to me, those people are really, they're threatening me. I'm not a leader of the Free State Project, but I'm a member of the Free State Project. And if you're targeting those people who are, then you're targeting me as well. And you're targeting all of my friends. And those people do kind of scare me. But I still have to be able to talk to them. And by talking with people, I find that I become less afraid of them. And I understand that most of the people's fears that they associate with the labels that they assign are based in an experience that they've had. And once you find out what that is and you develop a level of understanding and a level of empathy about where they're coming from, it's a lot easier to move forward with trying to actually get stuff done. So I'm going to show you something. It's going to take me a second. But right before I went to Occupy, like the week before, I went to a summit in, a conference, I guess. And it was, has anybody heard of the coffee party? Okay. So for those of you who don't know, the coffee party is this, it is supposed to be, well, I don't know what it is now. At the time, it was supposed to be a transpartisan political party. So a place where conservatives and liberals could talk about political issues without assigning the party line politics to it. And they had a conference with the Tea Party. And I think probably everybody knows who the Tea Party is. So the conference was, can the Tea Party and the Coffee Party have a conversation about, hold on.
Somebody help her out.
Thank you. A man of action, I appreciate that.
Man in the label, which I don't go by.
Okay, a human being of a helpful nature, which I much appreciate. Human beings, okay, I think. Nobody's been offended by that yet.
I go by humans or individuals.
Individual, I like that. Okay, so this was before Occupy, but this particular thing that I'm going to show you was what I figured out there and probably what I knew before there. If you look at these Venn diagrams, it's a really good way to show what people have in common and what they have differently. It's also a really good way to point out the political corruption in this country, because if you made one of these and you put Monsanto at the top of it, and you put Monsanto position, and then you put federal government position, you would have like 35 names of people right now in positions of power in the FDA, the USDA, like EPA, FBI, CI. It's ridiculous. But it's a really good way to see that.
There's a meme on that.
Yes, there is. I've actually gotten permission to print that, and I put it on posters, and I've like, it's a very effective way to kind of give a really quick lesson on corruption. So, when I was at Occupy, I used to sit up and talk to people at night, and they would tell me that they would start trashing on the Tea Party, and I'd be like, no, we really, the Tea Party is where I honestly started. Yeah, Tea Party was probably where I started, realizing that the government had overstepped its boundaries and that it needed to be brought back into place and all these other things. It kind of went off somewhere that I don't know anymore, and I'm okay with that. But the things that Occupy and the Tea Party had in common were things that would, like, easily fill this up. So does anybody know what Occupy and the Tea Party could have in common? If you do, just shout it out.
More government the banksters.
Huh?
More government intervention involved in society.
I would say that's something they had in common to stop.
Initially. They both have no problem using the tool of the government to mold society as they see it should be.
And that is where the labels get you fucked up. Because that's not true. As somebody who was in Occupy.
You're telling me I can't identify one Occupy member that has that label?
No, you can, of course you can, absolutely. I'm sure you could probably find several, but not all. And my experience in Occupy
I can see that not 100% of all Occupy members.
Right. And I can see why somebody would think that 100% of Occupy, 95% of Occupy members do. However, my
true Occupy member.
I don't know what a true Occupy member is. It's if it's the 99%, then who isn't included there? You know, which is part of what I would end up actually arguing with people, because it's I truly believe that there was a lot of voices being diminished by people who meet what you actually said, who were very vocal about making the government fix our problems. But underneath that were a lot of people who formed co-ops. If you look at what's going on in Detroit right now, there is a huge local food economy that's been built. There are time banks where people can work, and they can kind of get work done on their house by helping somebody else get work done by helping somebody else work on their house. They've set up medical clinics and mental health care clinics around the country. They have assisted people in finding homes. There's been a lot of things that kind of were ground up kind of things that came out of Occupy, and I think that that's actually what I heard a lot of in the Tea Party when I first started like learning about that, was that people have the ability to do more than we actually do. So I think, but I do think the role of government, I think it's fair to put that down as something they have in common, is that talking about the role of government, however that may...
And increasing in certain directions that they see fit.
Because I am part of Occupy and I don't believe that, I won't write that. Because that would be, it wouldn't be...
Huh?
I've got one. Opposition to the banker bailout.
That's true. Opposition to the banker bailout.
Opposition to NDAA, indefinite detentions.
Definitely. That was a definite one. Opposition to the wars was something that I saw in both. Yeah.
Let's talk about initial Tea Party
because I couldn't even honestly, I couldn't tell you about the Tea Party as it exists now because they seem to have gone off on a crazy train.
Co-optation,
Occupy, what you said applies.
Right, that's why I referenced no true Scotsman involved. You're saying anyone who believes this now and Occupy are real Occupy.
No, there's no such thing as real Occupy. There's Occupy is an idea.
To say that that's not really the Tea Party is literally no true Scotsman fallacy.
That the Tea Party believes
saying that anyone that the Tea Party doesn't really believe in it is not supposed to believe in it. The Tea Party members currently, for the most part, believe in it.
Maybe. Has that been anybody else's experience? Because
I couldn't hear what he said.
That the Tea Party promotes the wars.
Currently,
they do.
Yeah.
Currently, the original Tea Party as it existed when it first started, did it?
No.
Sort of.
Well,
so it seems like there's something. It seems like that's something that maybe isn't common and maybe is different.
Right.
Just like some occupiers thought government was the solution and some occupiers thought people are the solution.
Right. Portrays like Occupy's traditional leftist and Tea Party's traditional rightist. And that's where people get this stereotype image of both.
For sure.
Definitely.
It's interesting to me that, you know, your talk about labels. For me, part of the struggle, and even looking at the middle portion of your Venn diagram, is that Occupy, and I went down to the local Occupy site, was never really well defined. And in fact, I'm not sure I can define the Tea Party. Even back then, there was discussion
so
about
how can you
who is the Tea Party? Now, that doesn't mean that I don't have stereotypes, unfortunately, about the people on both sides. Quite honestly, I'll own those. but relevant to what you're talking about. I just wanted to put that out.
No, and I think that's fair. And I think, honestly, what you just said is exactly, if everybody just takes away what he just said, that you have stereotypes and you own them, then you'll have better conversations and you'll be able to be more productive in the work that you're doing. Because it's not necessarily, you're not gonna, look, I still call people names. I really, I'm ashamed of it, to be honest, because I would like to say that I don't. I'd like to say that I've moved beyond it. But I seriously, I'll read something sometimes and I'll be like, freaking, it's mostly statist, because I get so frustrated that I'll read something and I'll be like, freaking statist. And I need to move beyond that. And I own that. But it's hard. There's no way to just like flip a switch and be like, oh, all of a sudden I'm not gonna assign labels. Oh, all of a sudden I'm not gonna hear. I met a guy down the street from me one time. My kids went over for a play date with these people. And I had never met them before. And I was like, I'm not gonna talk about politics. I'm not gonna do it because I have already had experiences with my children's friends, parents, that I don't wanna replicate, so I'm just gonna not talk about politics. That, of course, did not happen. And in fact, I talked to the guy, and I met the mom, and we were talking about, you know, mom stuff, and then I met the dad, and he's military. And so we start talking, and he starts talking about the government, and I mentioned Occupy, and he goes, oh, you were part of that? And I was like, yeah. He's like, oh, I was hoping we'd be able to go and shoot you guys. I was like, oh, really? And he's like, yeah, I was really hoping we'd have to go shoot you guys. I was like, why? He's like, 'cause you're all a bunch of socialist fixes, and you know, went from there, and we're friends now. But why wouldn't we be? He didn't really want to shoot me. He was afraid because he thought Occupy was something. Oh, it died. Because it's the batteries. Yeah. He thought Occupy was something it wasn't.
Opposition to the war on drugs.
That's a big one.
I mean, if we're talking the pre-Obama Tea Party.
Yeah. That is something that I saw in common in both of those things. What I also saw in common was an understanding of the corruption. I would say that the response to that corruption was different. I would say there was an understanding of the corruption. From my experience, the Tea Party was a little bit more open to that corruption because money is power and it's okay to use your money for this. Is just come up here and help me, because I honestly feel like if you and I can have a conversation, then maybe everybody here.
I'm thinking about this here.
You're at Pork Fest.
I think the question might be, is the people who are in the Occupy movement or the Tea Party movement have their own ideas of what it is. I personally don't subscribe to any movement, but the people that would need to be here, you're bringing forth your notion of these two movements because it's really about what it is for you personally. But now we're trying to say what it is for everyone who subscribes to this, which is really, for me, kind of a waste of time. I get the
in this space.
I get like the motivation to do it, but at the end of the day, it's like, as I see the conflict starting between you two, it's again, the labels are getting in the way of the.
But that's my point, and that's why I preface this with, I don't have a plan and I don't know how to do this. I don't. And I don't, and I'm very likely going to be wrong in things that I said. And that's the reality of it. But somebody's got to be willing to risk being in this position.
Can I ask you a question?
Absolutely.
Why do you use labels like you said?
Because the only way to just, I actually have stopped using them again.
Okay.
Because the only times that I've used them, I spent more time defending the labels than I could actually talking to people about meaningful things.
You said that the targeting of the free state leaders or whatever, like, felt like an attack on yourself, and I understand that.
Yeah.
If somebody who can use all kinds of labels in the past, that's kind of why I stopped using it.
Yeah. my friends are still Free Staters. I still go to Free State Project activities. It's not, I'm not hiding, like, I'm still affiliated with the Free State Project. I am still technically a Free Stater because I signed the letter of intent and moved here. So I may not assign myself the label of Free Stater in conversation, but when somebody targets the Free State Project, they are targeting me as part of that project. Whether I assign the label or not, because it is, in reality, if you look on that list, my name is on that list.
They're not targeting you specifically, they're targeting the idea of...
Mm-hmm. When the police came to Occupy, they weren't targeting me directly, they were targeting who?
They're targeting their own fear. It's targeting.
But who is the target?
People.
That's a good idea.
Yeah. So it doesn't matter whether I am or am not that person that they're targeting in the Free State Project, if they're just targeting people haphazardly based on, like, a label like Free State, then...
Well, you don't know necessarily that they were targeting occupied people per se. They could have been targeting specific...
I actually do know they were targeting occupied people.
They could have been targeting people with backpacks or people who were men because they thought men were more likely to be aggressive against them.
The targeting that went on of people in Occupy went on outside of the camps as well. People had visits to their home. People ended up having special meters put on their outside of their house. The targeting of people in Occupy happened to people in Occupy. People who are nonviolent, people who were no threat other than telling other people that they had power and trying to help empower those people to use their abilities to the best, their skills to the best of their abilities.
What were the special meters that you mentioned?
I am the lucky recipient. The one, I got the golden ticket in Henniker. I'm the only house in Henniker that has a smart meter on it. They came in one day and they said it's a mandatory upgrade and put it on my house. I didn't know what it was. And I have two... I have two electrical meters on my house. I have my one that does everything but the water heater and then the water heater. They kept the water heater meter the way it was. They put this other meter that measures exactly how much electricity you're using in every room of your house and all kinds of crap. I don't even, whatever, who cares? I'm not doing anything wrong, they can measure whatever they want. They put it on my house. I'm the only one in Henniker that has it. And it went on when I was participating in Occupy. And that's like, and so I took a picture of a tinfoil. I asked my husband to give me the finger. It's the only time I've asked him. I'm like, please give me the middle finger. This is the only time it's gonna happen. And I put some tinfoil around it. And I made a tinfoil hat. And I stood next to the electrical meter. I put the hat on my head. And I took a picture of the electrical meter. And I posted it on Facebook. Because quite frankly, fuck you. That's the way I feel about that. But there was a lot of targeting of Occupy activists. A lot of my friends had visits to their homes. Some of my friends who had come here legally from other countries have been targeted and deported. Other friends are in jail. Other friends just had a lot of unwelcome guests and people sitting outside their house. It was a little scary.
But let's be clear, they were targeting anarchists, right, in the whole political realm, and anybody they assume to be anarchist, because that's a whole, in the war on terror, anarchists are one of the, that label is one of the labels that is in the targeting of the top four groups.
Yeah.
I'll talk about it at 5 o'clock if anybody wants to know. I'll tell you all about it in great detail. And smart meters is not part of it. I have a smart meter in my house.
Yeah, smart meters elsewhere in the country are the norm.
Right.
In New Hampshire, especially in my town.
That's not the way surveillance works, though.
Yeah, well, I don't know. All
I
know is...
I promise you.
Yeah. Well, that's why the tinfoil hat, though.
I love
because
that.
Because it's like the risk you run when you are, you know enough to know enough but not enough to know everything and not enough to know what you don't know is you kind of run on this, you're on this tightrope all the time of conspiracy theorist, critical thinking, whack-a-loon. And like, I'm trying to avoid whack-a-loon. But I have my moments. I mean, I do. Because our government put smallpox in blankets to wipe out the native population of this country. What else are they capable of doing? In my mind, that's infinite. He's had a question, and then you?
I just wanted to finish my thought, because I think we're actually in great agreement on pretty much everything. But what I see is... by saying people are targeting specific groups is the same thing that they're doing potentially to you, like as an occupied person that's targeting you, you are then putting the label of occupied targeter on them. And
yeah.
So it's just continuing, not necessarily, depends on how much, you know, will people put forth to getting to know each other before you do violence, but putting occupied targeter label on people then allows you to put them in the other category.
Well, and I think that when we, on Monday, I facilitated a conversation with Carla, Jared, Josie Wales, Larkin Rose, and Varen Swearingen, who's an FSP board member, about the use of force. And one of the things that I think gets really risky when you start talking about things like police is that other category. Because at some point, that person is still a human being. And that badge does not take away their human being status. It's not like you're a cop, so you're no longer a human being. And I think that sometimes that can get lost in the equation. Hold on, because she has a question. She had her hand up first. Or a comment.
I was just going to say something about the whole Wahoo label and, you know, conspiracy theorists and all that. And I find myself reading different things and hearing comments and that. It's like, well, that's just way crazy, and I can't even associate with that. But I try to stick back from that because I'm sure there are a lot of things that, in the wake of Snowden's revelations, that we wouldn't have thought about as being, you know, possibly true a couple of years ago that now we know are facts. And so, I mean, there's so much out there that they probably are doing that we don't know.
Yeah, I agree. And it's just trying to keep a level of perspective about it. A lot of times, my level of perspective comes specifically to this moment. Because it really doesn't matter what they're doing out there if in this moment I'm doing what I can do to make things the best I can. Otherwise, I'd live in a paranoid world of, like, looking over my shoulder all the time, and I don't want to live like that.
Oh, it has a little less punch because it's a couple minutes later. Just, I was going to say it right after you said the thing about police. Your former SLA co-host, I say former because you're not a regular anymore, but Antigone once said, I forgot who else was speaking at the time, but somebody said about cops and human beings, and right away, like, came, the rhythm was perfect, and she immediately says, since when are cops human beings? I think her point was because they voluntarily issue that because they put on the uniform. So
that's why Antigone and I made good co-hosts,
yeah,
because we had completely different perspectives on things
like
that. Yeah. I mean, there. I will not be the person that starts telling TSA agents that they should get a new job or something like that. I'm not going to get into it. They're working. Everybody's, in my opinion, and this is only my opinion, and you all can do with it what you want. In my opinion, the reason I'm an anarchist is because when I walk outside, not just here, I mean, more here than anywhere else, but when I walk outside, I don't think the person next to me is there to rob me. I don't think they're there to aggress upon me in any way. When I go to the grocery store, I don't think that there's, like, I do not feel like I am being threatened all the time by the people around me, because I believe that 95% of people, and I often am told that that number is way too high, but I don't care. I believe that 95% of people are just good people trying to get through their lives, trying to make the best decisions they can with the information that they have available and live to the best of their ability and provide for their families. So why would I be afraid of that? And why would I feel like I needed to be protected from that? It doesn't matter. You could disagree with me, and quite frankly, you're probably right in a lot of places where I'm wrong, and that's okay with me. At the end of the day, you're here. And to me, your being here shows a level of commitment to the same ideas that I have and the same commitments that I have to being free. So it's okay with me if we disagree. There is no threat to disagreeing. There is no threat to even getting passionate about disagreeing. When you start calling names, sometimes that can start to feel like a threat, because especially if you know a person well enough to know that when they start calling you a specific name, that their attention, their level of stress and tension is raised exponentially, you might want to hold back a little bit. But even then, I had somebody tell me that he wanted to shoot me. He was hoping they would come out and shoot us because I was part of Occupy and we're friends. It's not a problem to have a difficult conversation. But first you have to be able to kind of step outside of your comfort zone and feel that discomfort when somebody says, was hoping we'd get to shoot you, because there's nothing quite like it. You really don't know what to say in that moment. Because there was part of me that was like, there was part of me inside that really wanted to say, you motherfucker, what the fuck is your problem? Why would you want to go kill a bunch of people? What did we ever fucking do to you? What was that going to do? It would definitely have ruined the relationship for my children and for with us. And they turn out to be people who are growing their own food, people who are doing a lot of the same things we are. And he works in the government because he's afraid of the government, so he wants to be part of it so that when he knows what's coming, he knows he's not going to be targeted. It's actually kind of a smart strategy.
I think a lot of our disagreement is that you think that labels inherently mean poets or labels. And
oh no, sometimes.
I have an interesting story that there's someone famous in Liberty, I think, who hates me because on her, she had a third party friend, this female person, Asian, had a friend, Bob. Bob was complaining that Ron Paul was offering $200,000 speaking fees to the event, and he was saying, this is absurd, speaking for a couple hours isn't worth that much work. I'm a roofer and I put more work into an 8-hour day. I work harder, therefore I'm worth more money. Okay, anyone who has any understanding of economics knows what he's arguing for. It's called the labor theory of value. It's one of the fundamental tenets of socialism. So I said, your friend is a socialist. I don't really want to get into this debate right now with socialists. It's a much longer, it's not, to talk a socialist out of socialism, out of specifically labor theory of value, is not something I'm willing to do on a fucking Facebook Twitter, right?
Yeah.
Maybe in person. So I said, I'm not willing to talk to you as a socialist. So, and I was accused of calling him names. Why do you just write him off and call him names? Right? I didn't use the word socialist as a synonym for you're bad, you're not worth my time, you're beneath me. I use the word socialist because the word socialist brings with it logical content. And when people hear the word socialist, they go, ah, I know what he means, roughly speaking. You got to iron out the edges, maybe he doesn't believe in certain things. That's exactly why I use the word occupy or Tea Party person. If I have a friend, let's say I have a libertarian friend back home, and then I have another friend, and I would say, oh, you know, he's an occupied person, so let's not get into politics. I'm not saying he's an occupied person, so we can spit on him and talk to him. I'm literally saying that so they know where he's coming from. Usually, to most people, means that it comes with a bundle of certain information. He probably doesn't believe in the fundamental philosophical concept of private property.
Hey, point of order. Let me get you your own time slot, man. We go
okay,
to
I'm
here.
Done. I told you I don't want to get into it. I'm done. Thanks.
No.
Sorry. I'm sorry.
I have a response, but
I want to like reinforce what he just said because I have an engineering background, and I think in terms of efficiency, and any given person, you can ask that person a series of questions, typically binary questions or yes or no, but not necessarily. And depending on his or her answers, that person will fit the definition probably of something. So instead of, if you're having a conversation with this person, instead of a 5-minute preface whereby it's you asking that person questions, why not save time?
That's what the fuck a label is. It's time.
It's not, it doesn't necessarily entail being pariah, like a pejorative or, you know.
Yeah.
So
right.
It's just a time-saving efficient tool.
If I may, I think that part of the difficulty is that, like, when we're talking about sort of like occupying the Tea Party, we've already established that there isn't a lot of clarity about what these things mean. So when we use labels, we often bring our own associations. It's not always something as clear-cut as socialist equals labor theory value, because a lot of people would call themselves socialists who aren't necessarily familiar with the theory.
Damn
a lot of people might kind of, like, it's nice to think that these terms mean concrete, definitive kind of bundles of associations and beliefs, but I think that, like, these terms are mutable, occupies mean some things to some people, Tea Party means some things to other people. So if we just kind of use these labels as shorthands, we miss the opportunity to meet in a lot of useful ways.
All words are mutable if you don't have any common understanding. Literally, language can't happen.
No, for sure.
What do you mean by for sure?
Well,
I can play this game
to
the end.
You can interrupt me.
Okay, so hang on. This is why we're having this conversation, because the reality is that labels do serve a purpose for efficiency. In many instances, they can be very efficient. However, if I were to read you saying that thing about I'm not going to engage with the socialists, and I didn't know what that theory was that you just talked about, that might seem like name calling, because I didn't have that context.
Okay.
So sometimes, even if you said, even if you just prefaced it with, and I get it, it's a pain to take the time to say this, but even to say, your friend is basing this on this, which is a socialist philosophy, so I'm not gonna get involved in this because it's a waste of my time, then you've given context to the label that kind of takes the punch of it feeling like a name calling out of it. You've kind of given it context. And I think the more context you can give, the better. And I think that if people, when I was on my path to liberty, if people like Ian Freeman had like just called me a statist and left it at that, I wouldn't be here. But people were like willing to hear me ask my stupid questions, and I had some doozies. I didn't understand anything. I mean, I thought cop lock was terrible when I moved here. I couldn't understand why people brought guns to Occupy events when I moved here. And then I got banned for supporting them bringing guns to Occupy events. But honestly, labels do serve a purpose, and I'm not trying to say that they don't serve a purpose. But that purpose is not to help us grow what we need to grow in terms of community. Because those labels too often divide us. Go ahead.
I'd like to point out that the common understanding, frankly speaking, given if you're an anti-authoritarian, you do not have common understanding on many levels with most people, and your purpose is to bridge that lack of this misunderstanding and differences in philosophy, differences in views. And often we use labels that, you know, you have, your specific milieu and subculture has an understanding of this doesn't mean for, people just confuse another person. Like, keep in mind, there are people who believe, you know, Republicans in Congress are anarchists. Like, there are people who seriously believe that. That is true. There are probably more people who believe that than who actually know what an anarchist is. So if you call yourself an anarchist, they're going to see a thing. Either, you know, walk growing maniac or Republican.
Or somebody pooping on a cop car.
Yeah. But you say, oh, I support this, and that, they would probably understand you a lot better, and it'd be a lot more efficient, honestly, in my opinion.
Well, it's sort of like taxation is theft. Like, I understand that now, but the first time I heard taxation is theft, I was like, are you insane? Like, taxation is like part of like the social contract. It's how you make sure that everybody, like, I personally would like to see a system where you could select those things that you wanted to contribute towards, like a ballot box. So if you want to contribute towards the drug work, go ahead and do that, I guess. But if you want to, you know, pay, and I don't know, it wouldn't be taxes because it wouldn't be forced, but you'd be able to pay for those things that met your value system. But the first time that I heard taxation is theft, I had no understanding of what that is. The first time people started talking about kidnapping when they were talking about people being arrested, I was like, oh, you're being a little dramatic, aren't you? And I don't feel that way now. I don't feel that way at all now. But we have a language that we speak within our own community that is Greek to people outside of the community. And that doesn't mean that they can't learn the language, but first we have to talk to them in theirs. And we more than likely, we all know the language of the mainstream better than they know the language of what we're talking. I'll say the language of liberty, but frankly, I don't really think it's liberty. The language of freedom, I'll call it that. And I think that, you know, the more we can kind of branch out into those conversations. I know, there's no safe words. There's no safe words. Just act, just do, just be, and use words sparingly. And with that, I think I'm up on time. So I'm gonna end this. But thank you guys for coming and trying to help.